Hello everyone. Gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the VIP programme for Collect 2021, the International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft and Design. Supported by Loewe and Cox London, I'm delighted to be broadcasting live, not behind a laptop, for the VIP programme in our beautiful new Crafts Council Gallery, which sadly isn't open yet, but it will be soon, we do hope. I'm surrounded by beautiful pieces of contemporary craft from this year's fair, and it's being dressed with the stunning furniture, of course, by loaned to us by Cox London. So, what is the hottest contemporary craft to be investing in now? For this online version of the fair, we are running a series of four special VIP events called Collect Selects, each focusing on the different materials used in contemporary craft. You will hear from expert voices who will take you through their favourites, giving you an insight into why the work is so exceptional. So today we have Collect Selects number one, ceramics and glass in association with Sotheby's. So today we'll be discussing ceramics and glass with our esteemed partner for the talk, which is Sotheby's, and we have two excellent specialists with us. We have Robin Cawdron-Stewart, who's director and head of sales, modern and post-war British art, and he's joined by his colleague, Julia Fischel, who's also a specialist in modern and post-war British art. So Robin, are we having Robin on screen?
What does
Collect mean for you and for Sotheby's? And give us a little bit of context, that would be amazing. And we're excited to hear what you and Julia have selected for us.
Thank you so much for asking us to be a part of it. We are, of course, so excited to be here talking together. And I should just stress that we've both had our flow tests, so with negative results, so we are in safe territory, and we're also so lucky to be here with a few of the works, which we will be talking about. They're sort of popping up behind us. I'm sorry we're not going to be able to sort of get in closer, but no, it's such a pleasure to be here talking about Collect and the market for craft in particular, because the market for craft at the moment is so incredibly strong, and I think a lot of that has to do with the great visibility of craft at the moment. Over the last 10, 15 years, there's been this massive resurgence in craft, which has impacted not only the primary market through sort of the galleries, but also the secondary market through the auction houses. And that's of course where Julia and I come in. And I should stress that from the outset, we are specialists in the secondary market sense. So we're more familiar with, you know, handling the likes of Copper, Ree, Collingwood, that sort of thing. But here we're going to be picking out some of our highlights of the works in the Collect, sort of focusing on contemporary and emerging makers as well. And I talked about how exciting it is to be collecting craft at the moment. And I think part of the reason it is so exciting is because it's so incredibly accessible. I get asked all the time, or we get asked all the time, you know, what should I be buying? Why should I be buying it? And the great thing about pointing clients towards ceramics and glass in particular is that they offer not only sort of great breadth of material and sort of visual display, but also great breadth of price boundaries and barriers as well. And that's something that Julia and I will definitely be talking about. I know in the art world, money can often be seen as a scary thing to talk about, and it's a bit of a barrier to collecting. And that's one of the things I really love about Collect as a fair. The prices are by and large listed, and it sort of demystifies the whole process of buying and collecting. A lot of the time people ask us, what's a good investment? You know, what should we be buying now in terms of a possible increase in value? And I think our responses are always pretty standard. Never buy for investment alone. You should buy something because you love it and because you're drawn to it. Yes, you know, in a decade's time, it might be worth 10 times as much, but you also always run the risk of it being worth exactly what you paid for it. However, that's the great thing about Collect and fairs such as Collect. It's great hunting territory for the artists, the makers of tomorrow. And I think a really prime example is Edmond Duval, one of the most celebrated and sought after contemporary makers out there today. Very excited. He's got his talk coming up later in the week. Actually, I think it might be next week. But he, of course, showed at the very first Collect. And here he is today, as I said, sort of one of the most sought after second artists out there. So without further ado, I think we're going to kicking off and picking some of our favourite works from the fair.
Exactly. So there was a huge range of names for us to pick from. So we've been forced, our arms have been twisted, to select just a handful of the artists and the makers who we really love. I guess one of the things that's so exciting about being here today is just, as Robin was saying, how diverse the field is for makers. And although we're just narrowed down to look at glass and ceramics, I know that other people are going to be talking about other forms of crafts later on through the week. So we are kicking off with someone who I absolutely love. So this is Andrea Walsh, and we've actually got three of her works here to have a look at. She's being shown by Oxford Ceramics over the course of Collect. Now, Robin and I are both huge fans of Oxford Ceramics. They have a really, really exciting programme of artists. And as Robin was talking about, you know, we tend to deal more in the secondary market with makers, and they obviously have a really great kind of track record of offering those artists as well as contemporary makers. And they have a fantastic show on at the moment on female makers. And my personal, as you'll probably see from the works that I've picked out, one of my personal obsessions is female makers, really. I think that one of the reasons that craft is so exciting to me is because women perhaps are more prominent within it than they are in the fine art sphere, as it were. And I think that's something super exciting, and perhaps part of the reason why craft might have been sort of had a bit of a surge in popularity is to do with the fact that we're looking back to female artists who have perhaps been a bit overlooked by the traditional kind of art history canon, as it were. And so they're getting their moment in the limelight, which I think is super exciting. So this is Andrea Walsh. I'm sure lots of you watching this will know her work really well. She's a truly fantastic maker and someone who I think really deserves the sort of reputation that she's getting at the moment. So we've got three pieces here that are all contained boxes. And this is a series that she's really famous for that combines glass and ceramics, which is super interesting and sort of a wonderful way to kick off our talk of looking at these objects that have got both of these ways of making in them together. And what she's looking at, I guess, and what's so interesting is that we're looking at the idea of something that's super precious, of what it means to put something in a box, to contain it, to hold it, and then to be able to hold it in your hand. It's a bit like jewellery, and they do feel quite jewel and gem-like in the way they're made. In fact, the first one that we're looking at has got gold in it. So that really shows this idea of making something that's really special, that has some form of intimacy. And I think if you look at the scale for these as well, they are pretty small, so they do fit into the palm of your hand. I think these are beautiful pieces to live with as well, because not only could you put them on your mantelpiece and allow light to work with them in a really kind of amazing way, to work with the areas that are translucent and those that are opaque, and to go into the boxes and around the boxes, but you could perhaps also have them on your dressing table, I could imagine, because they have that feeling of being something that's really special and personal, I guess. Andrea Walsh actually, it's nice that we've got her here as well, because she was a Loewe prize finalist a couple of years ago, so that's super exciting. The price point for these are among the most expensive of the works that we're looking at, and I think that that goes to show something of the intensity of the process of making these, that although they look perfect and pristine, actually they're super, super intensive processes, because everything is done by hand. So all the molds are made by hand, all of the polishing is done by hand. There's very little in it that's sort of machine made, as it were. It's all just Andrea and the material, and I kind of love that, but then you can't see her hand in the finished process. It's sort of as if they were there and made and perfect, and it kind of disguises that intense work that goes into them. And that is partly the reason for the price point. Also, she is a very established maker. She's got, I think, 6 pieces in the V&A. So someone with a sort of really high profile, and I guess that makes them towards the higher end of the price bracket.
But actually, I still think really accessible.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, we're not talking the multiple tens of thousands.
No, exactly. It's all below 10,000. I think it's 9.5 for the two pieces, which I love, because it's that sort of like black and white, you know, the partnership and the duality and the looking at those. And I'm sure lots of you will know her as well for her. She does tableaus, so she places the works really carefully and looking at sort of relationships. So yeah, that's our first, Andrea Walsh.
Yeah, well, and then, you know, moving on to another great maker, and I think one of my absolute favourite contemporary ceramicists working today, as you can see on the screen, the wonderful, the marvellous Annie Turner. And much like Andrea's work, you know, you may be familiar with Annie's work. She was a recent Loewe finalist. And of course, Loewe are such an important brand in sort of the context of craft and the visibility of craft at the moment. So they're doing fantastic work. I love Annie's work. And I'm not sure I should, because I'm a Norfolk boy and she's a Suffolk boy. There's, of course, that rivalry, but I've always been drawn to it. And I think her work is, it is ceramic, but it's sculptural. It's so incredibly sculptural with her woven ceramic nets. She lives in Suffolk, and her work is really inspired by the River Devon up there, you know, an area that she grew up with, that she understands. Everyone I show images or the works of Annie too, and I show them to so many people trying to convince them to buy it, and often it works. Assume that they're metal, and, you know, first glance, these look like ancient rusted metal nets that have been dragged up. They are just incredible in terms of the construction and the process. It is so long. It takes so long for her to make them. It's such a labor intensive process, and you can really see that in the pieces, but at the same time there's something so wonderfully natural and ageless about them. I think her work really celebrates that sort of that masterful medium of clay, and also the kiln, you know, the process of firing, and it warps and distorts them. One of my favorite pieces by her is in the Fitzwilliam, and that's gorgeous, and it's sort of like an almost collapsed net. It's so engaging. It really sort of draws you in and makes you want to appreciate and understand her processes a lot more. Annie, like so many of the great craftsmen and women that we'll be looking at and are around today, was a product of the Royal College of Art in the 1980s, that golden era that saw people like Jennifer Lee, Magdalena Redondo come through. And I think at that time, the RCA, and they still do today, they had such incredible, fantastic teachers, the late, great Eduardo Paolozzi. So their work and the work of these makers really tread such a fine line between sculpture and ceramic. I think this piece we're looking at, the drift net, £8,500, I think that is such a bargain for what is, you know, the most important work that she is producing at the moment. You know, this is Annie at the best of the best, represented by Cavalleria Finn, a fantastic gallery, not only for established makers like Annie, but also for younger generation makers coming through. We're not looking at her today, but there's a great maker called Hannah Townsend that they also have. Her work is so excessively priced and really, really gorgeous.
Actually, when I was having a look at some of these makers over the weekend, I got a bit distracted by Hannah Townsend and I bought one of her pieces.
See, it's so easy to buy because they are at such an accessible price point.
I know. So moving on to our next, and actually we've got one of Peter Layton. Well, actually we've got two of Peter Layton's work behind us, and hopefully you can see these here. So we've got the coral reef and the blue piece here, and actually ties in really nicely with looking at Annie's work, because he's also someone who is really inspired by nature and by the landscape, and I guess these both are his works that are sort of related to the sea. So a trip to the Great Barrier Reef, and then we've got a wave piece here as well. I'm sorry that you can't see right up there, but maybe in a moment we can go back to the slide so you can have a really good look at what they look like. And
Julia, really quickly, could you just move your chair slightly so that we can see the camera? That'd be amazing. And Robin too, then everyone can see your chair. Move your chair, sorry. And that's it, amazing. Okay,
brilliant. So Peter Layton from Glassblowing, his studio. I mean, all of you will know him. He is sort of the great grandfather of glass making in this country. His studio in Bermondsey is super famous for being somewhere that is at the heart of glass and glass blowing in particular. And he has been sort of the figure who has brought about sort of the place where glass is at the moment. And he's overseen the careers of lots of other famous people who are being shown, great makers who are being shown at crafts, including Elliot Walker, who I think has gained a sort of huge online following after his Netflix great victory in the Netflix series. So I think these are fantastic pieces for looking at. I guess nature is one of those things, and the inspiration of the landscape is one of those things that we see again and again when we're looking at the makers that we're going through today. And these are just so full of joy and energy and colour, and I just absolutely love them. The pyramid form is a motif that Peter's really famous for, and it is sort of one of his most iconic pieces. And I guess one of the reasons why I really love these is that in them you get the sense that the process has become, that the process of glass blowing is there and it's captured and it's solidified. But you get that feeling of the energy and the...
They really are so alive.
Yeah, exactly. The energy, the sort of the danger, as it were, and also the joy and the vigour and the being together. And I just think that they're absolutely superb. I think they would liven up any home, any place that you could, really, where they get light. I think they're just absolutely superb and some of our favourite. And again, I mean, for such an established artist and maker, I really think these are very reasonable. And you would be in great company if you had these. I think that Prince Charles has got some of his, and Peter did a whole series for inspired by Highgrove.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, and also I think one of the other interesting things is that when we're looking at some of these artists, and I think Robin will go on to talk about that with Matthew Chambers, is how artists influence artists, or how art history influences artists as well, because Peter Layton is someone who has looked to Van Gogh with his sunflowers, or Klimt, to get sort of inspiration for his pieces too. So he's
looking
far and wide.
You can definitely see this sort of this inspiration of Klimt with these gorgeous colours, the patination coming through.
Yeah, and I love in this one that we can see the stripes going through. So you really get that sense of looking at tiger coral. So yeah, I think they're fantastic pieces. And we're delighted to have them here. So thank you very much to London Glassblowing for bringing them along.
Yeah, you'll need to check our pockets on the way out.
Exactly.
We'll be taking them home with us. Don't worry, we won't. And actually, as we've got them here and we're talking about them, one question I get asked a lot is, oh, I'm worried about collecting ceramic, I'm worried about collecting glass. Aren't they really fragile? How do I go about displaying them in the home? And this, you wouldn't believe how many times we get asked this question when people are thinking about buying it. And the response is always the same. It's, you know, that they're sturdy, they're stable. There is no greater risk in having a piece of glass or ceramic than there is having a picture on the wall or a print. Actually, in many ways, ceramics and glass are far safer to have because they don't get damaged by sunlight in the way that prints and works on paper so easily do. And they're far sturdier. And I think, yeah, these pieces really show that. There's a great weight to them. We were sort of preparing them on the table, like, oh, it's our workout for the day. Now, the next piece that I'm going to be talking about, Philip Eglin, one of my absolute favourite makers. We don't have the piece with us, but Isabel, I think you've got it there with you in the studio, and we can have a look round it. There we go. It's this big, beautiful, bold bucket form. Eglin is known for his bucket forms and his sculptural figures of, you know, popes, cardinals, Adams and Eves, as well as his plates, his sort of press molded plates with split design. I mentioned that he's one of my favourite makers working today, and that's really to do with the fact that he was one of the first contemporary ceramicists that I properly came across and fell in love with. When I was studying up in Edinburgh, they've got a fantastic piece in the National Museum of Scotland up there, a double figure sculpture piece in blue and white. And I wrote to him with some questions about them because I was doing sort of a mini dissertation, and the response from my art history teacher at the time, I don't think he's there anymore, was rather scathing. He was saying, you're here to do history of art, not history of ceramics. And I think that really shows how attitudes towards craft and ceramics have changed so much in the last decade. You know, when I was at university, it was very much sort of overlooked in favor of the high arts, but now they are celebrated as an art form in their own right, and rightly so. Philip Eglin, he's one of those artists, as I said, of the golden era of the RCA in the 1980s. Previously, he was, I think he trained at Staffordshire Polytechnic. And at the Royal College, he was taught by Paolozzi. I mentioned Paolozzi, and I think you can really see the influence of Paolozzi in his approach. It's sort of collaging different cultures, bringing together so many things, religious iconography, popes, cardinals, with footballers and sex. It's a great sort of hodgepodge mix. You really get a sense of looking inside his brain. This piece I love, because of course it's got the stripes, it's a play on sort of the pizza takeaway box. It's absolutely stunning, represented here by Ruthin in Wales. He lives and works in Wales. I think it's just such an interesting piece, as is the majority of his work, actually. The more you look at it, the greater the story it has to tell. And I know so many people that live with his work that say that's the piece that people keep going back to, keep looking at. And every time you see it, you see something new, you recognize something new. There's so much going on, these visual narratives. His technique of production is fantastic as well. On the back of this, not the pizza side, the other side, you get a sense of his graffito scratching into that beautifully wet clay or slip to sort of depict. And he's a great draftsman, a great drawer and artist. And you see that in a lot of the sketches he does as well. He's an artist that I have in my collection. He's also, I hate to say it, and I've never told him this, he's the only artist I have in my collection that I have sadly broken. And it wasn't me, it was a then friend who managed to break a beautiful slipware piece. And I had it restored, and I still have it, and I still love it every single part. And it's something, again, I think ties in with collecting. Damage isn't the end of the piece. If a piece gets damaged, you know, you don't need to throw it away, you don't need to dispose of it. You can have it repaired, you can still enjoy it and still live with it. Yes, there might be financial implications further down the line if you come to think about selling it, but it doesn't impact your thoughts towards the piece. This, I think, is probably the most expensive piece that we're looking at. It comes in just below 20,000. I think it's 18,000. But I think it is worth every single penny of that. He is such an important artist maker working today.
I think one of the reasons why I love him is because he's fun.
Yeah, really fun and really cheeky.
It's really easy to be serious in art, but it's really hard to be funny and humorous. Mm. And I think that he just really gets that. Like, it's just great. The sort of piece that you want to live with, you know. Some pieces you want to look at in a museum and some you want to have in your home. And he's definitely one you want to have in your home.
And as you saw from the gallery shot, it's so big. It's such a presence.
It's quite a centerpiece work, isn't it? Look amazing. Talking of people who went to the RCA, Edmund Byrne is another. There are a few, they're cropping up, showing the calibre of the students that the RCA produces. So he did a master's there, represented by Gallery 10 Scotland here. And I think this piece is also with you, Isabel. And I think looking at it there, we can see really the scale of it.
Wow,
I mean, it's
so
incredible.
Big.
It's such a massive piece. And for the price that's being asked for it, I think this is... I think I would say this is my bargain of the pick.
Your bargain buy.
Yeah, my bargain buy, exactly. I think I absolutely love this piece. I think Edmund is a fantastic experimental artist. And I really love him because I think he's at that intersection of where a maker and like a chemist or a scientist really come into play, because he's like an alchemist, the way that he experiments with what he's doing. And he's really interested in the idea of chance and order and that duality of what happens when you start putting heat into things. He had a display at Collect last year with a glassmaker called Addy Tock, and I think that was a really interesting moment for him. And I think that's been a bit of a turning point in his career, actually. So I think he really is someone to watch, because one of their pieces that they made together, so combining glass and metal and experimenting with what happens, with what chemical reactions happen when you put those two together. And one of those ripple bowl pieces got bought by the B&A from that last year. And so I think he really is one to watch. If we go back to the slides, we can have a look at the title of this, because it's really interesting. And I think he is quite an intellectual as well as an experimenter and a maker, because the title of it is Metameric Stag. And what he's doing is he's looking here, or the metameric works, and he's looking at basically how the eye can be fooled and the subtleties of colour, both of which I think are really interesting, because they're questions that are traditionally looked at by sort of fine artists or high artists. And in this, he's taking those questions and looking at them in craft. So basically the idea is that two colours can look identical to the human eye, but when a third colour is placed in there, we see that actually the two colours are not the same colour, but they're different colours. So this is the pink and the purple, and we get this idea of this optical illusion, whereby we show that the human eye is fallible, and that colours are kind of all powerful and all supreme. And I think that's a really interesting thing for him to be looking at. He's also using offcuts of some of his pieces here, which is quite interesting as well. So looking at kind of reusing, repurposing, taking bits of other works and putting them into different works, so they sort of link together visually when you see them as a whole. He also does sort of landscapes or tableaus, so you see a number of pieces and you can kind of draw links between them. But at the same time, as well as doing something that's sort of quite scientific or intellectual, cerebral, I think this piece is super playful, and I think that's really fun. I love the pastels of it. I love the textures of it, the warping, the rippling, the stacking. I think it's a really fun piece. And he's also quite interested in the idea of making pieces look old. So there's something quite timeless. Some of these pieces are called totem stacks. So there's something about things being timeless or out of time, but then also feeling really contemporary all at the same time, really avant-garde. And he puts this crackle on them to make them look like bits of found Roman glass. So I think he is a maker who I really love, who I think is doing lots of really interesting things, and is kind of having a moment of being really just full of very fruitful ideas and fruitful experiments. And yeah, I think this is a great piece. And as we can see in the video, the scale of it is so amazing.
I can't believe that price. It's sort of sound like we're on a shopping channel. Such great value for money, and such presence as well.
Yeah.
Definitely. It would look so well. It sort of reminds me of the work of William Turnbull, in the way he does his sort of his totemic sculptures that he works the surface of. And I think this would sit so beautifully in a contemporary setting alongside those sorts
of
works.
Exactly. And I think the comparison with Turnbull, and also talking about Annie Turner and Eduardo Paolozzi earlier, the way that he makes these surfaces is so interesting to me, because he does drawings on like a really big scale, and then he tries to take the energy and the vigor and the mark making of those drawings, and he translates that into the molds that he uses for these. So the molds themselves have those same mark makings from the drawing. So he's using these different art forms, the drawing and the making, to bring them together. And there's something very Paolozzi and Turnbull-esque as well, with our sort of modern British hats on, being quite excited by that. And really, I guess, of where craft and sculpture come together, where they have overlaps. So yeah, this is a real favorite of mine.
I could tell your face lights up looking at it. It's so interesting that you're talking about sort of the interplay of craft and sculpture, and that I think that leads so beautifully on to our next maker that, you know, sort of we've picked out Matthew Chambers, who is a firm favourite in the Collect Fair. And you'll recognise his work. It crops up in so many glossy, high-end interior magazines, because they photograph and they sit so well. They are so incredibly beautiful. They are ceramic sculpture. And we're really lucky we've got one piece here with us today, which I lean back slightly. You probably can't see from where you are, but it's this beautiful sort of pastely pink with sort of a powder blue inlay. His pieces are magnificent. And there's a bit of a sense of mystery surrounding his process of sort of manufacture. And again, everyone I show them to says, oh my gosh, how is that made? They ask whether it's sort of solid, it's been carved out. It's a process that involves throwing, basically, but don't want to give too much away, because I think that mystery is really part of the appeal behind his work. I love this piece. I think the great thing about Matt's work is the accessibility in terms of his price points. Again, if we go back to the slide, here we go. So £2,800 represented here by Cavallaria Finn.
And actually what's interesting is that in the slide, I think perhaps you can't see quite how pink the outside really is. It's such a beautiful pink.
He is very much inspired by, you know, the canons of modern British art history, and of course Hepworth in particular. And you just need to look at this and your mind immediately jumps to Hepworth and her studio down in St. Ives. This is a Hepworth sculpture for a fraction of the price, but saying that is in a way maybe just doing disservice to it, because it's not just Hepworth. It is something very unique. And I think Matthew's work is unique in sort of the context of British ceramicists at the moment. He treads such a fine line between ceramic and sculpture. They are a great weight. They're so incredibly heavy. It's my workout for the day, sort of lifting it over. He is, I think, of all the artists that I've looked at and that we've talked about and I've seen as part of the Collect Fair, he's the one that I think offers great value for money. I'm blown away by his prices, that they are so accessible. And I think, yes, he is a good name to watch. And I think this is something that I would like to be taking home with me.
I think it's interesting that we're comparing him to Hepworth, because Peter Layton also talks about Hepworth as being a big influence on him, and he says he likes his curves Barbara Hepworth-esque, which I think is a great phrase. Okay, so moving from Matthew Chambers then onto Tanya Pack. So again, a sort of favourite of Collect, and I think this photo is really interesting, actually. It makes the works feel so sort of otherworldly, like they're on a moonscape almost. But yeah, a fantastic glass maker, glass blower. And these are called opaline breaths. And effectively what she's doing here is sort of taking glass making and glass blowing back to basics. So she's literally looking at the glass, the blowing, gravity, and her breath. They are, in essence, a distillation of the human breath, of what that could look like, what that does look like when glass is around it. These are, I guess, quite sort of challenging to make. They require a team of very highly skilled glass blowers, many layers of glass to get this effect. And she talks about, and actually I've got a quote here from her, which I think is really interesting, looking at these, talking about these works. Sometimes our sense of loneliness and timelessness unfolds and makes one gasp for air in their own intimate space of experience, which I call the in-between breath. It is the moment a breath stops, frozen in time. And I love these works. I love how conceptual they are, how cerebral they are. I think they are really quite spectacular pieces. She's someone who writes really poetically about her work, really intelligently about her work. I think that these are, I think these are fantastic. She does different forms of breath, some that are in white and some that are in black. And she talks about these as having a duality. So the white ones are sort of the airiness, the ethereal side, and the black are the more earthy, they're in touch. So these, I guess, talking about essentials and elementals, they're two different kind of elemental ways of working. When we've been talking about other artists we might compare these to, I think these really remind me of Anthony Gormley, Rachel White-Read, that idea of turning nothing into something, of showing what can't be shown. You know, breath is something, air is something that we can't see, but here she really has turned this into something that we can see. She's captured it and presented it in glass. And what's quite interesting with the opaline glass is that she's using something that has a really long lineage, a really long history, and she's taken it and she's made it super modern and super avant-garde. And yeah, I think these are amazing. Also, she's quite an interesting artist to collect because you can buy sort of a whole scape or you can buy one piece. So there's a price range for them. And here you can see that they've got a price range from £2,000 to £5,200. She is being represented by Joanna Bird, who is, of course, one of the best gallerists, the best kind of proponents for craft and for makers.
And ceramic and glass in particular.
Yeah, exactly.
Really at sort of the forefront.
Exactly. And she had a really interesting show over last summer that was half virtual, half not virtual, called, I'm probably going to absolutely murder this Italian, but Auto Rita, which is, that was a terrible accent, wasn't
it? No,
it's
fine. I was impressed.
All about it was called sort of the all about the self-portrait, or she commissioned her makers to make things that were self-portrait or something that best represented them. And Tanya Pack had a wonderful group of these breaths in there, and I think one of the really interesting things is how heavy these are. So it's not something that we can really gauge from looking at the photo, but they can be up to 12 kilos. And Joanna Bird was talking about that. I mean, that is seriously heavy, 12 kilos for a piece, which just goes to show, I guess, how worked they are, how much glass is in there. And I think that's an interesting idea of the breath as being kind of a representation of us, because it is so, you know, it's really the essence of what it is to be human. So yeah, as you can tell, these also, I'm very enthusiastic about them.
Well, Gina, I think maybe her work more so than any of the other makers we've looked at today, really photos do not do it justice. Videos do, but it's seeing them and experiencing them. For anyone that sort of came to collect last year, seeing those, I think actually this slide is from collect last year, the way Joanna had them displayed on sand, there was this ethereal quality to them.
And I love the fact that she is an installation art, you know, that installation is a big part of her practice, and that in other sort of site-specific installations, she employs special lights and lasers and music, and she's really influenced by minimalist composers, which I guess is no surprise, but Philip Glass and Eric Satie are composers who really inspire her. I love that idea of that all-encompassing, that immersive way of experiencing art. So I think definitely a highlight for me, and I can't wait till we can not be virtual and actually see these in the flesh.
And then this sort of brings us nicely on to our final slide, our final pick from the fair. And as I think I said at the beginning, Julia and I are specialists in the field of modern and post-war British art and crafts. But for the last slide and for the last pick, I know we've been very sort of British focused. I wanted to pick something that's not by a British maker. And here we've gone to South Korea. And this is being shown by the Hand Collection, who have partnered with the, again, I'm going to apologize for my mispronunciation, the Incheon city, which is a sort of a small ceramic city southeast of Seoul, the capital. And part of the reason I picked this is looking at all the images and all the works that were being displayed as part of the collect fair, this is one that really struck a chord to me. Not necessarily for the maker, I've never come across the maker before, to be perfectly honest with you, but really for what it is, this beautiful, this incredible, this breathtaking moon jar, which itself is such an icon within the field of studio ceramics, or the field of ceramics in general, not just in South Korea, but really internationally. It's sort of the recognized hallmark of what ceramics can be. Looking at this, I'm immediately drawn back to that beautiful Snowden photograph of Lucy Ree sitting beside this big monumental moon jar. And I think the process of manufacture here is amazing, sort of two throne bowls which have been joined together and sort of covered in a white slip. It really is so serene, so beautiful, and it, I think, shows the great timelessness of ceramics. This is something that was made recently, but could have been made, you know, 1,000 years ago. Ceramics, yes, it changes, the processes evolve, but at the same time, artists and makers, they're working with the same materials that have always been around, doing the same things, firing in the same ways, in many respects, and creating these beautiful monuments that are so accessible and really so delightful, and are a real joy to have and to own. I think ceramics and glass really put the fun in collecting, perhaps because they aren't at that high price level. People who collect ceramics and glass, they do so because they love them and they have a passion and an understanding. They buy them and they collect them because they love them. And I think that's absolutely the right way to approach ceramics and glass when you're thinking about collecting.
And I guess one of the things that we haven't talked about that much, really, by virtue of the fact that this is virtual, is the tactility of collecting and living with ceramics and glass. I think it's something that that we find when we're handling works for ourselves, is that we're constantly picking them up and putting them down and looking at them and turning them around and holding them up to the light. And that's something that's really an experience that you get so much with ceramics and glass. And I guess both of them are also really sort of involved processes, particularly for the ceramicist, that you're really getting your hands in the material. And that's something that I think is really special about collecting them. And it's quite fun having this straight after the Tanya Pack, because we're talking about timeless and eternal, and her forms really have that feeling as well of being carrying on that sort of lineage of things that do feel timeless.
Absolutely.
Guys, that's been so interesting. I've been riveted. I thought I knew quite a lot. We could go on.
Yeah. It's a good thing.
No, well, it's just, you know, I thought I knew quite a lot, but goodness me, you've enlightened me in so many ways. I think a question, we've got a couple of questions coming through, but one of the questions I wanted to ask was, clearly you guys work very much in the secondary market, but I think what's interesting is, I think sometimes people think the secondary market is you have to be dead and you have to not be around. And actually, by talking about Edmund, and actually a lot of the people that you're talking about, it's really interesting, I think, for people to understand how fast somebody can rise and actually end up in the primary and secondary market, and maybe explain a bit about what that means, the terminology, the jargon, because we know what that means, but other people may not understand what that means.
Well, definitely.
Yeah. by primary market, we refer to the galleries that are selling them brand new. If you think about it like a car, you know, off the showroom floor. By secondary market, we mean that they have been owned previously. And that could be one careful owner, or it could be, you know, 20 careful or not so careful owners. But it's definitely really interesting to hear you say that, because a lot of the artists represented and shown at Collect do have a great secondary market presence. And a lot of, I think it's probably more geared towards ceramics than glass. I don't think necessarily that the secondary market for glass has developed in the way that it deserves to. And I think there's still great scope for development in the secondary glass
exactly
market.
Who knows? And I think maybe if you were someone who wanted to have a bit of a gamble and invest, then maybe glass would be the way to go, because
absolutely. It
hasn't yet really, I mean, you know, we, our main avenue for offering ceramics at auction is our Made in Britain sales, which we have twice a year, and we don't really sell glass in that at all, but ceramics is very much at the heart of those sales, and we absolutely love having the ceramic pieces there. Our next Made in Britain sale is next month, and we have a number of artists in there who are living and who are being shown at Collect, like Edmund and Magdalena and Jennifer Lee as well.
Yeah, I mean, the Adundo that we have coming up in the sale, I think it goes live on Friday.
Yeah.
Yep. All things going to plan. The Adundo that we have coming up is just breathtaking, and a 1980s piece. An estimate of £30,000 to £50,000, but it really is, it's sublime. Also in the sale, we've got two brilliant Jennifer Lee pieces. Lee, of course, was a graduate of the Royal College of Art alongside the likes of Annie Turner. And her work, I mean, she's a great example of five, 6 years ago, the secondary market wasn't that strong for her. But now her pieces regularly command in excess of £20,000 at auction. And we've seen some staggering results. I think the record £37,500 for a piece by her that we sold a couple of years ago now. They are beautiful, and her work and so many ceramicists have a really international following. I think Britain, and again, sorry for being British biased here, Britain does craft so well. It's a great export, and I think people internationally recognise the importance of British craftsmen and women.
And I think one of the other things is that we really have to take our hats off to the gallerists and the dealers, because if we're being absolutely honest, they're the ones who make the markets. They are the ones who take an artist and they really champion them, and they put on exhibitions and they write catalogues and they commission great academics and curators and tastemakers to write essays on these makers, and they really commit to them in the long run. And I guess, having looked through these slides, as well as talking about the makers, we've also mentioned the galleries by name, and they're the ones who have really got the eye to find a great maker and to see their career through, to take them from their very first show with them all the way through to making great results at auction. And they are so instrumental in the way that an artist's profile can be raised, and really kind of supporting and developing that market. And so although they might do primary, they are also really essential in the secondary markets too.
That's really interesting to hear, and it's so important. It's obviously why we do collect, and it's the gallerists that are the ones who are showcasing the artists. And that kind of quite nicely answers one of the questions that came through as to how an artist, an up-and-coming artist, can get in front of collectors and understand what they want. And it's through a gallery, because they gallerists very much nurture a career of an artist and help them in that whole process with a collector, and also, you know, with you guys when you're selecting for your for the auctions and what have you. And did I hear you said Magdalena Redondo is in your up and coming?
Yeah. The piece we have coming up, it's a beautiful black burnished piece.
We're very excited about it. It's
very,
really
good.
Interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's amazing. And just for the audience to know, Magdalena is part of one of our keynote speakers on the Fielding talk, which is this Friday on the 26th. So
I'm so excited.
Yeah, we're going to be there.
Yeah, we'll be logged on and listening.
Such fans.
And it's just amazing in this world of being able to connect across the internet. We've got extraordinary numbers that are going to be attending that as well. So fantastic. I'm just checking, see if there's anything else. Yes, this is quite interesting. Loewe Foundation, obviously, and we work, the Crafts Council work very closely with them. BBC Radio 4's Women's Hour, the prizes set a few years ago. Are there any other companies that you have seen that have been really embracing working with craft, or that you've been impressed with?
Of course, you know, I think Loewe is definitely up there as the, you know, the luxury brand embracing and recognizing the importance of craft. But I think other luxury brands are beginning to cotton onto it.
Yeah.
If you just sort of, yeah, if you have a look at some of their other stores. Also, I think magazines are so important. You know, House and Garden, it's one of my favorite magazines. It's fantastic. It's a gorgeous, beautiful read. And they're so good at showcasing new makers as well.
And yes, I should have mentioned that Andrea Walsh was, of course, a finalist in the Women's Hour Craft Prize. So that was really sort of an important moment for her and her career, and great to have that sort of exposure. And I think anything like that, you know, prizes, grants, perhaps sort of, yeah, being able to travel, those sort of things are all really important for
yeah.
artists. And Andrea also had her 6 months in industry, which was incredibly important. So those kind of partnerships with companies, with industry, can be really helpful for an artist in perhaps not so much sort of profile, but in helping them with their creativity and developing their ideas a bit. And also, I guess one of the other things that we should talk about is how popular crafting shows on TV have become. And I think that is something that is really helping with the profile of crafts.
Yeah. And social media as well, Instagram. Wow, we've got a whole hour nearly without talking about Instagram. But Instagram and social media platforms like Instagram really are so important for getting the makers' works out there. You know, with Instagram, your audience is unlimited. And that's really where tastemakers come into play. Of course, people like Jonathan Anderson, the creative director at Loewe, is great for shining a light on new emerging makers, as well as sort of established names that for one reason or other have gone under the radar.
It's really interesting, because one of our partners that second year they've been working with us is Brookfield Properties. So they have a huge number of properties that they own within the City of London, and they're doing an award with us, so they are purchasing for the Crafts Council collection. It's a fantastic award. And then they work with the artists, and they then showcase them within their buildings within the city. And then they actually purchased some work last year. So I think it's fantastic that there's a lot of businesses and cultural that want to kind of connect with cultural things, and they tend to just go to the fine art, but it's really exciting for us that people are really engaging much more in the contemporary craft design world. And Cox London obviously is another one of our partners who also is just it really understands about craftsmanship and has been working with us for several years. So no, it's just really, so you know, if anyone's listening who's in any of those businesses, get involved. It's the area to be involved with.
And I think it will only develop further as people become more and more aware of what things are made of. You know, I think we're moving away from the mass produced and we're moving towards the handcrafted. People are becoming increasingly aware of sort of the unique aspects.
Amazing. So I think I'm just going to come back on camera very briefly, put my computer down. So amazing. Thank you so much, both of you. That was really, really interesting and really insightful. And I'm sure everyone was hanging on every word. So, and thank you to the audience and for your questions. And we hope you enjoy the rest of Collect. This will be being recorded so other people can access it afterwards. But thank you so much, and enjoy the rest of the fair. Goodbye.